Andrew here. I'm an economist, and I've started out looking at some of the regional costs and economic costs and benefits of exclusion fencing in Western Queensland, picking up from where Ben was talking before about some of the environmental impacts of exclusion fencing. So we started doing some monitoring and evaluation, MERI reporting on exclusion fencing in 2016 for the in a long reach area. And we started this work. Hang on. So some of the background from an economic point of view was declining regional employment, declining regional populations, a shift from sheep to cattle over a long period, and when wool prices did turn around, people's reluctance to go back into sheep, partly because of the existence of wild dogs. Sheep populations in Queensland declined from around 18 million to about 2 million, so a decline of nearly 90%. Populations decline because you need more labour when you're running a sheep enterprise than you run a cattle enterprise. Jobs decline. So we're talking here about the sort of slow death of a lot of these regional communities. So along came exclusion fencing, largely to give people the option for enterprise choice within their enterprise, so that while some people may choose to keep running cattle, but at least if they've got a fence up and they can control dogs, they've got an option to go back into sheep. We were doing these kind of rapid in central Western Queensland. Quite detailed MERI reports on impacts with a lot of data in there from economic data. And what the feedback that we were getting from our client was that all this information is fantastic, it's a great report, but people don't read reports. So we decided we'd have to come up with a different way of trying to communicate to people what these impacts of these exclusion fences were. So that's when I introduced Tim to see whether we could take another look at how we could communicate this data. And so Tim.
So yeah, I run a data visualization and design company. When Andrew and Rapid came to us, it was pretty clear to us immediately that what they needed was a narrative. They needed not just a website with a bunch of statistics on it. They needed to be able to tell the story of what was happening and give it some empathy, some relatability, by not just showing what's happening. It was important to show what was happening, but it was also important to talk to people about their experience. So I'll just scroll the correct way here. So we developed this site called Not Just a Fence to tell the story not just of how the fence impacted landholders, impacted the community, and the way to do that. We've made it more sort of nice and simple to understand, a few sort of self-building graphs as you move through it. Make it about the impact on the community. So we've got a series of interviews with impacted, not just land, people who have had their family move back to the region, people within city council or town council that have seen their town change. And the other thing that we really wanted to get across was the bang for buck that the government got from investing in this, so that the communities that were involved could demonstrate that what the government was getting back what they actually put in, and that it was, you know, a worthwhile investment for Queensland. The, you know, we've got a there as well, and some economist giving his perspective. And then we love as well. We can zoom into and out of this map and click on an individual, get the statistics for that particular cluster, including sort of cheap numbers and lambing rates. Have a little video interview or a case study. So we were able to do that by providing a visualization interface to all of the cluster data that was already gathered within Andrews Merry. This site was really positive, including because this was commissioned through RAPID, which is a local government organisation, but the Queensland government sort of were impressed by the
style.
And we're now a week or two away from going live with a statewide version. And that's a more interesting beast because it has a lot more interactivity built into it. So we've got six regions across Queensland that are represented here. And I might just give you a snippet of the new site, which the new site is going to take over the Not Just Defence domain. So at the moment, when you go to notjustdefence.org, it's the RAPID site, but the RAPID's actually giving that over to the Queensland government. So you can see here the regions that we're dealing with. We can see how far the whole project has gone. Round three for the whole state, we can change that to all three rounds. We can see, because rounds one and two are just about complete or are complete, whether we get with that, we can go one or other of the regions, and we don't just change a little bit of the story. We also change the videos and the backgrounds and interviews that we've done, so that here I am looking at all rounds in Maranoa. This is with the original RAPID site, but also a lot more sort of depth because we're able to filter it. And we're not just able to filter it, we've got the rounds one, which I've briefly done. We can go within the region to a specific LGA or electorate, which means you can see the impact on one particular electorate if that's what you want to do. And we can go back in time and see how the thing has progressed. Let's see if I just change this to a different one. We've got a different color scheme, a different group stats and different interviews. And this is all set up to be simply and easily added to. So we can add new regions and we can add new data. We're adding new data every month as it comes in, see how far the fences have gone. And if we want to add a new round, we just need to add any new regions and their imagery. And we're off and running pretty well. And the other thing we did as part of this is we conducted, as part of the MERI process, or a range of workshops in each of the regions to get feedback, to get an understanding of how it was working on the ground. And we also went out and conducted the interviews on different themes within within the impacts of the fence on the community. So that might be mental health, it might be changes in population, it might be a feeling of security, being able to sleep at night because you know your sheep aren't being attacked by a bunch of dogs, that sort of thing. And so we shot those and sound engineered them and then edited them and subtitled them, and for a total of, I think, 14 little video interviews, as well as shooting the video backgrounds and the still backgrounds and gathering the data. And so that's where the map is a lot more complex now. If we go to all regions, my file drops down a bit there, and you can see the sheer number of clusters we've got here. Some of them are considerably smaller the further east you go, whereas the ones out west are just enormous. But that's all, you know, again, if I make that only round three, rounds one and two fade back and are no longer. So it's really easy to see what, where any individual slice of the data that you're interested in is at the moment. That's probably close to our time, and hopefully we've got enough time for one or two questions.
Thank you both very much. Another incredible talk, and it's just insane to see the extent of these cluster fences across the state. It's really growing at a pretty massive rate. Definitely something to keep an eye on. Just while we're waiting for any questions to come through, if anybody wants to pop any in the live Q&A box, please go for it. I've got a couple in the interim. I'm just wondering, you've both obviously had a lot to do with talking to these stakeholder groups and working out what sorts of data that they're interested in. Have you got any models around what the role of cluster fencing might be in terms of increasing the long-term sustainability of pastures in these areas and having that greater control over managing herbivory and total grazing pressure? And is that something that people are interested in and that you might have some models around?
Certainly, yeah. And I was really interested in Ben's research that he's doing. Grazers will tell us that they're seeing increased biomass and they're seeing increased species diversity. Ben's obviously perhaps not observing that yet, or and the evidence that we've got is anecdotal. So they're anecdotally great, and I'm sure grazers are trying to talk the story up, but talk up the positive aspects of it. But they're saying they're seeing increased ground cover, increased habitat for small critters, and all these other benefits from having greater control over total grazing pressure. And I guess there's a lot of people looking at this to make sure that grazers don't necessarily take the opportunity to increase domestic livestock numbers in replacement of the macropods. So if you take the macropods out and control total grazing pressure, so long as you don't then turn around and increase your domestic livestock numbers, we should get a grass or biomass response.
Yeah, it's interesting. Ben's data doesn't suggest that there's much evidence for that happening so far, but
I guess
it's a pretty tricky climatic situation. So,
been a bad drought up here for the
last won't make any judgments yet. That's interesting, though. You mentioned that people are reporting improved biodiversity outcomes. Do you think that that's something that people are also interested in, something that you might use this like amazing communication tool to increase the sort of conversation around? Is that something that you're hearing from these communities?
Yeah, definitely. There's certainly interest, and it'd be great to be able to demonstrate that. And I think the tool that we developed with Kim would be it's a great spot to be able to communicate that. If we can, you know, who knows, maybe work with Ben or others if we can get the data to support those other aspects of it rather than just a you know, slant towards the economic side of it, if you know what I mean. So in short, there's certainly interest in those other outcomes, including that Tim mentioned, the social welfare type outcomes that we're coming through very clearly, and they come through in the videos. Anyway, it takes time to have a look at the video interviews. They come through in the verbatim comments that we get from the workshop. So and as I say, we've got anecdotal evidence coming through there about environmental benefits, but we don't have any scientific evidence of that yet.
Sounds like a collaboration waiting to happen. There's another question here from Susan Campbell. Tim, that was an excellent data visualization. Oops, sorry, I've lost the question. excellent data visualization website. Are you familiar with similar sites for other invasive species related programs?
Not that I've been. Because I deal more with the technical side, I'm much more familiar with DataVis in a more generalized way. In the DataVis community, the content or the actual data is interesting, but it's not as critical as the approach that's taken to visualize it. And a lot of sort of the research that we do is around how to get weird and wonderful data, data that's not predictable, data that you haven't actually had a hand in producing, and finding the best way to portray that and to get the meaning out of that, you know, in a way that is true to the actual data, not what you want to actually get out of it. And so there's been quite a lot of interesting work done on approaches to visualizations that aren't standard maps and charts and graphs and the like, but actually are dictated more by the data itself. So that's my long way of saying that I haven't done much research specifically in the invasive species or the vertebrate pest space, because our job, my part of the job, is to take what the client has and turn it into the right visualization for that.
Yeah.
And the actual content of the data is, while this is a really interesting subject for me, and it just happens to be an area that I'm interested in, the actual subject of the data is in some ways irrelevant to my job.
Possibly some opportunities to collaborate with the feral scan team as well then, in terms of their data processes. One last question from Warren Schofield. I was wondering if there's been any evidence of increased impact from pest animals and properties adjacent to clusters, and whether the cluster fences are creating a divide in the community like a gated community.
Still a bit too early yet. There's concerns about that, and there's certainly clusters that are linking together. So there's, if you look at the map of Tim, there's corridors, and in some cases, some of those corridors are now getting closed off by people linking two clusters together. So what might have been a property that for whatever reason was outside a cluster may then inadvertently become inside a cluster because you can join two clusters together. And that might cut off that corridor. But then there's corridors down the main river systems. Still early days in terms of that community reaction inside and outside the cluster fences. It was always expected that the subsidised cluster fencing would effectively act as a demonstration model for other people to perhaps see the benefit of it, and they may then make their own decision to add on to it. So that's certainly happening as well.
And there has been some feedback that has been what has happened. A number of those videos do mention that, you know, they saw it happening in round one and wanted to get on in round three after they saw some of the results. But that was from a particularly just a land management pastoral perspective.
Excellent. Thanks, Matt.